Hey, this is Doug for Round Home DIY, and in this video, I'll be building this Roubo-inspired workbench. I started with the top using 2x8s, and I split it into three sections so that I could glue up the boards as quickly as possible after surfacing them. I worked on the middle section first by cutting the boards to rough size, taking a few inches off from each end, leaving about 2 to 3 extra to account for any planer snipe later. I then ran one face and one edge of each board through the joiner before passing them through the planer to get a final thickness of 1¼ inches. Next, I ripped the boards into two pieces by running the jointed and then newly cut edges against the fence of the table saw. I also cut two small scrap pieces about 4 inches wide to use as spacers when making the legs later. After surfacing and cutting the boards, they tend to warp slightly. To help correct some of this, I made a few clamping calls to go across the top and bottom edges of the boards during glue up. Then it was time to apply some glue. For this, I used Tightbond 3, which has a longer open time, so I didn't need to rush quite as much. I tried to move quickly and spread the glue using a hard rubber roller, which works really well. Once the glue was applied, I clamped the first call on, and then flipped the boards over to make it easier to attach the other calls. Then I added all the remaining clamps, and flipped it back over to make it easier to clean up any glue squeeze out. While the middle section dried, I repeated the same steps for the two remaining top sections, except for the two outermost boards on the front and back. These boards will be laminated later so that the through mortise for the leg's tenon can be created by simply using a spacer block. This avoids having to chisel the mortise holes and results in a very nice fitting joint. Next, I rough cut a single 10-foot 2x8 board for the long stretchers, leaving enough room to cut off a 4 to 5 inch spacer for use when laminating the lap joints and the legs. Also went ahead and cut the boards for the legs to rough length at the miter saw, leaving about 4 inches extra for a spacer when laminating the mortises in the top. Since the 2x10s that I wanted to use for the legs were wider than my joiner, I went ahead and ripped them to rough width using my bandsaw. I then cleaned them up at the joiner and planer and ripped everything to final width at the table saw. Then after cleaning up the top of the leg pieces at the miter saw, it was finally time to glue them up. Each leg consists of three boards laminated together. To create the tenons on the leg, I clamped two of the spacer blocks that I'd cut earlier from the top to the middle leg board. This matches the mortise that will be created in the top later. To avoid having to use a dado blade, I also cut the front board and used the spacer block from the stretcher to create a lap joint. After applying glue, I used a pair of parallel clamps as calls to remove any slight warping, and then came back with more clamps for the actual glue up. Once the clamps were in place, I immediately removed the spacer blocks and cleaned up any glue squeeze out. I ended up with a very small gap between two of the boards and one leg, so to fix this, I made a simple filler from some pine sawdust and glue mixed together. After it dried, I sanded it down and started cutting the legs the final length at the miter saw. And these odd shape cutoffs were what I actually ended up using as spacers later for the mortises and the top. Before moving back to the top, I went ahead and drilled a few holes for the linear bearing and leg vise screw at the drill press, as it's much easier to do now. I'll cover this in more detail along with building the chop in our next video. To finish up the top, I started by cutting the left end of each laminated section at the miter saw. I then cut the boards that contained the leg mortises into three pieces. To make sure that the matching front and back pieces were identical, I made one final pass trimming each pair together. Before gluing these into place, I went ahead and drilled 3/4 inch dog holes as deep as I could with my Forstner bit so that it would be easier to finish making straight holes later with a spade bit. Next, working from left to right, I then glued up the three pieces to form the two mortises using the spacer blocks from the legs. And again, once everything was clamped down, I removed the spacers and cleaned up any excess glue. After the glue dried, I finished up the section by gluing up the outermost board and then just repeated the same steps for the last section. I then moved to the floor and started cleaning up the bottom of each section by sanding any glue squeeze out before switching to the hand planes to roughly flatten the boards. I had originally intended to run each of these sections back through the joiner and planer, but they were starting to get pretty heavy and my middle section actually ended up a little bit wider than my joiner. So I focused on the areas around the mortise to try to avoid any gaps once the legs were added, and while I was working in it, also checked to make sure the sides and bottoms remained square. Once I was happy with the fit between the sections, I took them to the miter saw and cut them to final length, which ended up being just about 6.5 feet. Then it was finally time to glue up the three sections to form the top. I glued the rear and middle sections together first, and once those dried, I glued up the front section. Before moving on to the legs and stretchers, I decided to route a groove on the bottom of the top along the front for a board jack or sliding dead man, which I'll be adding in a future video. Assembling the entire base and then trying to get all four tenons to fit in the top at once didn't sound like a lot of fun, so I decided to fit each leg first and then attach the stretchers to them in place. Once all the legs were dry fit in place, I marked and cut pieces for what later would become the inner half of the short stretchers. I could then clamp one in place as a spacer and mark the exact length of the outer half of the stretcher. After cutting the outer boards to length, I headed over to the table saw and cut a small bevel on the ends to make it look a bit nicer. I then took them to the drill press and counterbored two holes on each end and clamped them back into place in the legs so that I could pre-drill and then screw them into place temporarily. Next, I repeated the same process with the long stretchers, starting again with the inner half and using it as a spacer to help mark the outer half. For the long stretchers, I made four counterbored holes for each lap joint and again pre-drilled and temporarily screwed the stretchers in place. Once that was finished, I removed both of the long stretchers and then the legs and short stretchers on the right end to prepare for the first step of this glue up. I started the final assembly by applying glue to the mortises and tenons on the right two legs first. Once the legs were in place, I then glued and screwed the outer half of the right stretcher onto the legs. To keep the legs in their proper alignment while the glue dried, I screwed the long stretchers back into place, and this also gave me something to clamp the legs down to as I didn't have a pair of clamps that were quite long enough to go over the entire leg. After the glue dried, I repeated these steps for the left two legs and stretcher, and then I went ahead and glued and screwed the long stretchers to the legs as well. I then eased the edges of the legs and stretchers a bit with a block plane and some sandpaper. I also beveled the bottom of all the feet to help prevent tear out when the bench is moved around on the floor. Next, I applied a bit of boiled linseed oil to the bottom of the top and some of the legs and stretchers. With a little help from a friend, we then flipped the bench over and I started working on finishing the stretchers. I applied some glue to the inner stretcher and clamped it into place using a scrap piece of 3/4 inch thick MDF to position it so that the final shelf would sit flush with the front half of the stretcher. I then pre-drilled and used a few screws to hold it in place while the glue dried. After repeating this for the other stretchers, I then marked and cut the final inner stretcher for the left and right sides. This is a bit overkill, but I had some leftover pieces for it, so I thought I might as well add them. To hide the screws on the stretchers, I cut some half-inch poplar dowel into plugs at the bandsaw. After gluing them into place, I came back and sanded them flush, and then finished up with a little bit more boiled linseed oil. The next big step was to flatten the bench top, which was basically a repeat of what I did for the underside. I started by using my number 5 plane to knock down most of the high spots, and every so often I would use a little paraffin wax on the sole, which helped quite a bit. After a while, I switched to my number 7 plane and just used my longest straight edge at different angles to check which areas needed more work. And once I was happy with how flat it was, I started drilling out the remainder of the dog holes. To prevent any tear out on the underside, I clamped a small board in place before using a spade bit to finish drilling the holes. To finish the bench top, I sanded it with 80 grit sandpaper and eased over the dog hole edges a little bit before applying a final coat of boiled linseed oil. To finish up the bench, I measured and cut a piece of 3/4 inch MDF to size for the shelf. I then used a jigsaw to cut out notches in the corners to fit around the legs. After a little test fitting, I wiped down a little boiled linseed oil, mostly just to darken the MDF, and once that dried, I applied a coat of paste wax. Well, that pretty much wraps up the workbench itself, and so far I'm really happy with the way it turned out. In the next few videos, I'll cover the leg vise and sliding dead men builds and install an end vise, so be sure to subscribe if you haven't. And if you haven't already seen our SketchUp and Fusion 360 tutorials covering the design of this bench, be sure to check those out as well. The Fusion 360 tutorial covers the creation of a fully parametric bench that makes customizing any of its dimensions extremely easy. As always, if you have any questions or comments about the build, please leave them below.